this, and to have Andy with us today. Andy is a good friend for a long time, and we just remember today that I reviewed his one of his earlier NIH grants, and which was funded, and so we have
the one that wouldn't come.
And so we date many years ago. And in fact, one of the first places that I used to visit and give seminars and so on was at Columbia University in pharmacology. You have to know that the Department of Pharmacology at Columbia University College of Physicians and Surgeons is cardiac electrophysiology. And Andy continues a long and distinguished tradition at that institution, starting with Brian Hoffman and Paul Cranfield and Andrew Wartburg with both of them, and has contributed a tremendous amount to everything that we know about cardiac electrophysiology, including a fantastic book on the arrhythmias of ischemia and infarction that we wrote together with Phil Jensen. I used to use it in my lab almost every day.
He bought one of the 10 copies.
I bought the 11th copy.
I was reading that Barack Obama, his income went from $100,000 to $4 million because he wrote a book. Didn't happen to me.
Never mind. Anyway, there's not much else to say, and we're happy to have Andy with us today.
It's really a pleasure being here, and it's a pleasure meeting all the people associated with biomedical engineering and others as well, and also new acquaintances with all the friends. I'm going to. This is the title that I sent in for my talk, which basically is, I'll talk about something later. I'm going to start with stuff that I am very comfortable with. We've been studying myocardial infarction in a canine model, and I've been doing these studies for probably close to 30 years. And I'm going to start with material that I feel very comfortable with, which is our in vivo studies of arrhythmogenesis in a canine model of infarction. I've been forced over the last 5 or 6 years to become molecular. I've become molecular by associating with the right people. That material, I'll show you what's going on in what used to be my laboratory, but which has been taken over by my molecular colleagues. And I'm a little less comfortable presenting that, but I sort of have to as part of my talk. But what I've always been interested in for the past 25 or 30 years is the substrate for ventricular arrhythmias and ischemic heart disease. Substrate can mean a number of things. It can mean changes in myocardial structure that occurs during ischemia, which is related to geometry in the infarctic region. It's related to how the myocytes are connected together. It's related to a phenomenon called anisotropy, and just recently we've come up with a new proposal for changes in extracellular resistivity that may be involved in the arrhythmogenesis. And then there are the ion channels themselves and ion channel remodeling. And this has been approached by one of my colleagues, Penny Boyd, and so I haven't been really involved too much in this aspect of the substrate for arrhythmias in our animal model, and I've been involved more in this aspect. So this is our model. This photograph of an infarcted canine heart is probably about 25 years old. It's one of the
initial series of animals that we did. And what we do is, this is a canine model. We occlude the left anterior descending coronary artery fairly near its origin. We get a very large enteroseptal infarct in the region supplied by the LAD. And the reason that we like the canine model and we study this in the subacute phase. Most of our studies are not on acute arrhythmias. We study the electrophysiology probably 4, 5, 6 days after coronary artery occlusion, which is a different phase of arrhythmias, a different mechanism of arrhythmias than the acute phase of arrhythmias. And this is where we focus our efforts. So why do we use the dog? The ECG changes in arrhythmias are very similar to humans. Durham and I were discussing a little while ago that there are a lot of studies going on nowadays using mice, and particularly mice because of taking advantage of transgenic animals, and there are a lot of problems studying ECG and arrhythmias in mice. Mice are not men. And so the dogs, the ECG changes in arrhythmias are similar to humans. The coronary circulation is similar to human ischemic hearts, not to normal hearts. There's been some argument in the literature because the swine heart has a coronary circulation more similar to normal human hearts with a lateral. The canine has a lot of collaterals, but ischemic human hearts have a lot of collaterals as well. So once you compare it to ischemic human hearts, the coronary circulation is fairly similar. There's a lot of aspects about the cellular electrophysiology that's similar to human hearts, not identical. I know Yoram and Tom are interested in comparing or working out models of human myocardial cells, but to the best of our knowledge at this stage, there's a lot of similarities between canine cellular electrophysiology and human hearts. And the large size is great for collecting electrophysiological data. We can do things in the canine heart that we can't begin to do in small animals. So what happens after you occlude a coronary artery in the dog? The initial insult from occluding the LAD is you get a very large region of damage towards the endocardial third of the left ventricle, as shown in this dark area. And then with time, there's a wavefront of necrosis. This was originally described by Bob Jennings and in a publication back in the early 70s. A wavefront of necrosis which moves outward towards the epicardial surface. And by a week or so, 4 or 5 days after the coronary occlusion, we have well-formed border zones around the infarcted or the dead tissue. We have an epicardial border zone, as indicated here. There are lateral border zones, which border the lateral aspect. And there's an endocardial border zone, which is very thin and composed mainly of Purkinje fibers that survive. This region survives because of collaterals. This region survives because of oxygenation from the endocardium from the cavity. And there's collaterals here. So when we're talking about infarction arrhythmias in this stage, that is 4 or 5 days after coronary we're not talking about the electrophysiological properties of the infarct per se. This region's all dead. There's no electrophysiology in there at this stage, unlike the very acute stage, like 1 hour after occlusion. We're talking about the electrophysiology of the border zones. Border zones are surviving myocardial cells, which are surrounding the dead tissue and which have abnormal properties and which generate. And particularly in this particular canine model, at 3 to 5 days after coronary occlusion, you can induce
sustained ventricular tachycardia by a technique called programmed electrical stimulation. This is stimulation used by electrophysiologists in the human electrophysiology laboratory to study patients who have a history of arrhythmias by applying electrical stimuli to the heart with a certain pattern, that is basic stimuli, boom, 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 and then an early stimulus. In hearts that have the propensity for arrhythmias, you can induce ventricular tachycardia. In hearts that don't have a propensity for arrhythmias, you can't induce ventricular tachycardia. This canine model, you can see here, we're stimulating the heart at a regular rate, applying early premature stimuli, shortening the coupling interval, and when we get down to a coupling interval between the last driven ECG and the premature ECG at 190, we get a sustained VT. The reason that we're interested in this model is that this sustained VT and this response to program stimulation duplicates almost exactly the response to the human heart with ischemia program stimulation under certain conditions. So again, going back to my slide, why is this a good animal model, or at least why we think it's a good animal model, it duplicates some of the characteristics of human arrhythmias, and that's what we want to see in the laboratory. The other thing that happened, which was really quite unexpected, was the development of that epicardial border on the surface of the heart gave us a model where we could map excitation in the laboratory without using more heroic processing, more heroic techniques. Let me explain that in a little bit more detail. The epicardial border zone, these are surviving myocytes on the epicardial surface. And since they're on the epicardial surface, you can put a multiple electrode array right on the epicardial surface of the heart and map or follow excitation in the epicardial border zone. And I went to Netherlands in the late 70s and worked with Maris Alessi for a year and learned how to do multiple electrode mapping. That was not done in too many institutions in this country. Came back in 1980 and we built a system which allows which then was expanded, allows us to report 320 simultaneous sites on the epicardial surface of the heart, and we would put map. And it turns out quite fortuitously, we didn't know this when we started the study, that the arrhythmias arise in the epicardial border zone. We found that out by mapping. And the fact that we can map with just this kind of electrode array means that we didn't have to deal with three-dimensional activation, which would have made the whole thing much more complicated. This is from one of our original papers, and you can't see the numbers. I took this from a PDF file from some research 20 years ago, so I just made this long slide recently. But it shows a map on the epicardial surface in three different experiments, and what it really shows is, first of all, how this epicardial border zone is activated during sinus rhythm. And I'll just take one panel here. So this is that electrode array sitting on top of the epicardium. This is where the left anterior descending coronary is. And during sinus rhythm, the wavefront activates from the sides, and the center region here is activated last. This is totally abnormal because the wavefront can only get into the epicardial border zone from the sides, from the margins like this, because the region underneath the epicardial border zone is a little different. Normally, in the normal heart, you would see the impulse coming up from the endocardium in the middle of the electrode array and spreading out. The other thing that I want to call your attention to in these maps of sinus rhythm is there are no regions of block. This is all activated slowly but smoothly from the margins into the center. And when you do the program stimulation protocol, you get ventricular tachycardias and you can map is a very high resolution re-entrance circuits. And this was one of the first, I don't remember my history so much, and we all have to thank all us old guys like to think that we made major contributions to the science, and so I could say, well, maybe this was the first example of mapping high resolution complete re-entrance circuits in the inside to the heart. And some other old guy will come up and say, no, we did it at the same time, or we did it first. So I can't remember, so I'll say it, but somebody may call me a task. But let's take an example here. If you look at one of the early maps that we published, and you see the resolution, you can't see the numbers. All these dots are activation points, but you can see that's a pretty good resolution for mapping in the inside to dog heart or inside to heart, and we just have to follow the arrows. And the sequence of activation is around this dark line, which is the line of block now. So we have a line of block forming, which was not there during sinus rhythm. And around this dark line, this is the line of block forming during VT, but was not there during sinus rhythm. This pattern of two reentrant loops around two parallel lines of block with an area of common conduction in the middle was named by Nabil El Sharif, who's working on the same problem at the same time, so he probably published at the same time. He called this figure of eight reentry, and that terminology has remained in the 25 or so years from the time it was originally described. And the area in the center of the figure of eight reentrant circuit is called either the central common pathway, because it's common to both reentrant pathways, or it's called an isthmus. And as techniques developed over the years in clinical electrophysiology, figure of eight reentrant circuits with fairly good resolution have now been mapped in the human one. So this was studies in the dog heart that actually predicted what would be found in the human heart. And the pattern is very important because in order to ablate VT caused by figure of eight reentry, you have to find the isthmus to put your lesion. If you ablated over here or over there, you know, one of the circuits would keep going. So the pattern is not, was more than just academically interesting. So one of the early things that we set out to do, this is sort of a historical talk, so I can put off the molecular part as far as possible. By that time, you will all be one of the things we want to know is, okay, why the line block? Why the lines of block during VT? And what's the reason for slow conduction in this water zone? So we focused on connectivity, while Penn and Boyden focused on action potential characteristics. And so at that time, Matty Spock was publishing, very active in publishing studies on anisotropy in heart muscle. Anisotropy means that the impulse conducts with different speeds and different directions related to the orientation of the myocardial fibers. Rapid conduction along the long axis of the fibers and slow conduction transverse from the long axis. It had originally been described in the heart a number of years before. Matty began his work in the late 70s and early 80s, but it was sort of ignored like any basic electrophysiological properties are until somebody sort of thinks to be useful, and Matty proposed that it could be involved in arrhythmogenesis. This is from one of his early studies, which shows papillary muscle stimulating in the center, and you can see that in the long axis of the myocardial fibers, as shown here, there's very rapid conduction. You can see that the isochrones are widely spread, and which indicates rapid conduction. And you can see in the transverse axis here, is very slow conduction, and the isochrones are bunched together. So this stock called uniform anisotropy and is a property of normal myocardium. There are other things that he described which are very interesting, electrogram characteristics, action potential upstrokes, etc., which we don't have time to discuss. And then he looked at disease. This was actually not disease, but in atrial fissure from older patients, which he obtained specimens from during open heart surgery. And he found that in these kinds of atrial specimens, rather than seeing that nice uniform elliptical isochrome, you would still get fast conduction in the long axis and very zigzag type conduction transverse. And it turns out that this was a result of fibrosis that was separating the myocardial fibrovessels, and he calls this non-uniform anisotropic conduction. So we have uniform and non-uniform anisotropic conduction. And then he published a model, and a lot of this is based on studies from Jeff Safin's laboratory, where they did very detailed morphometric studies of the distribution of different kinds of intercalated discs, of gap junctions in the intercalated discs. And from those studies, we learned that cells are connected to each other mainly at the ends of the cell by what's called the plicate gap junctions, as shown here. And even the side-to-side connections are at the ends of the cell in the interplicate region. So there are no connections between cells along the lateral membrane, but rather all connections are at the ends of the cell, both the longitudinal connections and the side-to-side connections are all within the gap junctions at the ends of the cell. In the interpolated disc. So this is the interpolated disc here. These are the interplicate connections in the lateral direction, and these are the plicate connections in the longitudinal direction. And then when you go down the lateral membranes of the cells, you see there are no gap junctions connecting cells along the lateral membrane. So that becomes important later on when I describe what happens to the distribution of the gap junctions in this epicardial border zone and have coronary occlusion. That is how they're remodeled. So that's essentially the electrical model that we use to think about gap junction distribution. So we did some studies in the canine epicardial border zone which were similar to the studies that Spock did atrial tissue from humans and in normal ventricular muscle. So this shows an activation map. Here is our electrode array, as I showed you before, sitting on the epicardial border zone with the apex of the left ventricle down here and the base of the left ventricle up here, the left anterior descending artery here. And we simulated in the middle of the epicardial border zone and we watched the propagation of the wavefront. And this is the pattern that we got. We got fairly uniform and rapid conduction in the longitudinal direction. This is the longitudinal direction of fiber orientation in the epicardial border. And we got extraordinarily slow activation in the transverse direction. I wish I had a slide of normal myocardium, but I don't. But see how close these isochrones are packed together. So you're going from sinuous origin to an 80 millisecond isochrone over this very short distance in the transverse direction, where you're going from sinuous origin to an 80 millisecond isochrone all the way down here in a longitudinal direction. So right away, the conclusion was, okay, this is a highly anisotropic region with non-uniform anisotropy. The epicardial border zone. So maybe this is one of the causes of that conduction block. And it turns out that during ventricular tachycardia, this is a map without the activation time shown, but just a map during ventricular tachycardia. Here are the isochrones, here are the arrows. Just be easy to follow the arrows and trust me that we drew them correctly. One arrow going around this line of block, one arrow going around this line of block. And it turns out that these lines of block locate themselves in the regions of very high and isochrones. So there's some relationship between the high non-uniform and isotropy and the lines of block that happen during ventricular tachycardia. So this anisotropy may be rate dependent, and since this tachycardia is usually going in a cycle length of 170 or 180 milliseconds, which is faster in the dog heart than in humans, we get what we call functional anisotropic block. At least the review has accepted that explanation. That was in the 80s. Okay, the other interesting thing was that in some of these experiments, you got multiple morphologies of ventricular tachycardia. You induced tachycardia on a number of occasions, and you got different ECG patterns. So, for example, in this particular experiment, this is lead one and two of the electrocardiogram during four different morphologies. You can see that the ECGs look different during this tachycardia than this tachycardia. They look different during this tachycardia than this tachycardia. But it turns out that even with the different morphologies, the lines of block are the same in most of these experiments. And so this just compares activation maps from two different morphologies. This shows one. Again, let's just look at the arrows. We go around this line of block here. We go around this line of block here. That causes one morphology of VT, and then we induce it again, and we get another ECG morphology, and the lines of block are the same. The wavefronts are just going in the opposite direction. So we're generating multiple morphologies of VT, but the lines of block are in the same place, which also shows you that there's a high propensity for block in a special region of the epicardial border zone. It's not just random where the circuit locates. It's not just random where the lines of block, form. Interestingly enough, there are now some mapping studies in human VT with multiple morphologies, and many multiple morphology VTs originate from the same region as shown by clinical maps. So it's not totally unlike the canine. But again, the idea is there's a specific region that's prone to conduction. The other interesting thing, and I'm going to come back to this maybe later, but I have so many slides that I probably won't get to. We also plotted the location of the lines of block relative to the thickness of the epicardial border. I showed you, you know, the wavefront proceeds towards the epicardial surface. It leaves a rim of tissue, but that rim of tissue is of non-uniform thickness. It's thicker towards the margins that connect with normal myocardium, and it gets thinner as you get towards the middle. And this is a plot that Nick Peters did of the thickness and number of cell layers. And it turns out that the lines of block form at a transition region between a thin region of the border zone and a thick region. As you can see here, going from 70 to 530. This is not quite as obvious over here, but it's possible that the location of lines of block were not precise at this time. The methodology was a little different. Wasn't quite a precise methodology. If you just move this line block over a little bit here, it would also be a big jump in thickness. And thickness comes into our thinking about how the lines of block form, and I'll try to get to that a little bit later on. So we have high We have non-uniform anisotropy with marked transverse conduction delay in the regions where the lines of block form, and we have a transition of thickness between the very thin epicardial border zone and a thick epicardial border zone in the regions where the lines of block form. So, again, now back to the topic that was advertised. Gap junctions, I don't need to spend any time on this. I think everybody knows gap junctions are the channel connections between myocardial cells. They're located in the intercalated disc. And the most important thing to remember is that in the ventricle, the proteins that form the gap junction channels are called connexins, and there are a whole family of connexins named according to their molecular weight in Daltons, and in the ventricle, connexin 43 is the primary membrane-spanning gap junction, and connexin 43, I'll get to more about the details of connexin 43 later on. But connexin 43 is the protein that forms gap junctions. And again, going back to the stock model, this is a diagram from Nick Peters. The ends of the cell, remember I said there were plicate gap junctions at the ends of the cell, which cut through the cells in the longitudinal direction. And there are gap junctions in the interplicate region, as shown here, through which impulses propagate transversely and also longitudinally. And again, this is mainly on basis of multimetric studies from the static flow. Okay, so Nick Peters came to work in my laboratory in the middle of the 90s. In the middle 90s from England, he trained with Nick Severs, who is one of the pioneers in the study of gap junctions. And I knew nothing about gap junctions. I probably barely knew what they were based on basic physiology. Nick had taken part in a study by Smith et al. That was published in the Journal of Pathology in 1991. Let me just describe to you very quickly what this is. So, people use antibodies against connexin 43 to localize the distribution of gap junctions in the heart. So, if you have an antibody to connexin 43, you expose tissue to that, and then you use a second antibody which has a fluorescent molecule attached to it, and then you can do immunofluorescence studies and locate the distribution of connexin 43. And in a normal heart, you can see here, this is the location of connexin 43, so that's the protein that forms gap junctions. And this is the orientation of the tissue. This is the long axis of the tissue. And the connexin 43 in the intercalated discs are located mostly at the ends of the cell, like I described before. Now, Smith and Peters and a bunch of other co-authors in Nick Severs' laboratory studied border zones of human influx. So this is variable myocardium in human influx material. And they describe this pattern, whereas the connexin 43 was no longer confined to the ends of the cell, but now was located around the entire perimeter. So connexin 43, you can see all along the longitudinal margin of the cell, all along the longitudinal margin of the cell. This was interpreted to mean that gap junctions actually formed on the lateral membrane. But remember, you're only looking at protein. You're not looking at the gap junction structure per se. But it was interpreted to indicate that there was sort of migration of gap junctions. And now the whole cell was covered by gap junctions. And this is sort of the fetal phenotype. In the fetal myocardium, gap junctions are not confined to the intercalated disc, but are located around the whole cell. So Nick said, well, let's look at the epicardial border zone of the canine and heart, because that's all we do. So he was going to study gap junctions, he had to study it at MR. And so what he did was he took reentrant circuits, we induced reentrant circuits in the dog heart. This shows the activation maps. Here's the figure of eight pattern with the conduction around this line of block. Conduction around this line of block here. And very carefully, using some very innovative techniques where he pins the mark. He did online activation marking so we could see the circuit in the lab. And then at the end of the experiment, we marked very carefully the sites where the lines of block were and cut out tissue underneath the reentrant circuit. We divided the tissue within hundreds of squares and looked at the immunofluorescent data from each of those squares. Devised a semi-quantitative method of scoring the lateralization of gap junctions. Now, if you look over here, you can see, in fact, that in the epicardial border zone, there is lateralization of the gap junctions. The distribution is very similar along the long axis of the myocardial fibers. Remember that in normal myocardium, it would only be located at the ends. And then when he reconstructed the epicardial border zone, it turns out that the lateralization was only in the central common pattern. And this is the region where there's lateralization. This is the region of the central common pathway. And the lines of block formed at the interface between the remodeled connexin 43 and the non-remodeled connexin 43. That's interesting. But I don't know, you know, what's the mechanism of the lines of block. It still didn't help. And we still don't know the mechanisms of the lines of block because we did some experiments. Then I'll show you the data, but I can't do so. And then I'll go on to the model. Yeah.
Sure. So you have that border all around. And you have, you see the figure of eight is like this way from this way?
This is the figure of eight.
So you always have this along the longer border. So
this is always oriented along the long axis of the myocardial fibers because the lines of block are formed during transverse propagation.
So the lateralization in the circular loop,
yes.
The junctions are perpendicular to the direction of conduction.
This is the direction of conduction, and this is perpendicular to the direction of conduction.
So the, all I'm trying to say is that the gap junctions are expressed not along the direction of conduction, but perpendicular.
Right. And right now, then, I'm going to switch from calling this lateralization of gap junctions to just calling it lateralization. Reason. When do we stop? I just engaged my. Well, don't say like 7:30 or something like that. 5:30?
No, it's 6:15, so. I mean, minus 7.
Okay, so now I get it confused. And I'm just going to show you some data, but I can't really tell you yet what the role of lateralization of connection 43 is in the formation of the lines of block. And I'm going to show you some data and then we'll come back and we can discuss this. Okay. So to try to figure this out, what we did was we induced reentrant circuits in the dog heart. This again is the figure of eight reentrant circuit. And we took blocks of tissue, both from the central common pathway, where there's lateralization of connexin 43, and from the outer pathway, where there's no lateralization of connexin 43, And we use these blocks of tissue to disaggregate single myocytes or myocyte pairs. And some of those myocytes were used for touch plant studies of various ion channels in different regions of the reentrant circuit. And the myocyte pairs were used in dual patch plant studies to measure conductance between cells. Okay. And Penny did all the ion channel work, and I'm not going to mention anything about it here, except to say that she found reduction in sodium current with different degrees of reduction in the outer pathway versus the central common pathway. So that opposed my working hypothesis that all slowing of conduction and block was due to problems with connectivity, or actually with changes in sarcomere ion channel and sodium currents and also calcium and also for engineering. So Jin and Yao did dual patch plant studies. This shows just an example of the preparation. And we looked at what we called side-to-side coupled cells, and we looked at N-tag coupled cells, which are not shown in this particular micrograph. But these cells, you can see, they're two cells that came apart, sticking together side-to-side, even though we know that the connections between them are probably only at the ends. And then there were end-to-end coupled cells. And with the dual patch plant method, you passed current and measured the conductance between the myocytes. And it turns out that in the outer pathway, where there was not remodeling of connection 43, there was still normal distribution of connection 43, there was a marked reduction in coupling in the side-to-side direction versus control. And in the central common pathway, where there was remodeling of connection 43, there was no reduction in side-to-side coupling. And the data turned out the wrong way around. And then in the end-to-end direction, they were all the same, both the central common pathway and the outer pathway. Okay, so we can store those data, but I don't know what to make. And then what we did was we measured conduction, both in the central common pathway and in the outer pathway, by simulating and mapping a very high resolution spread of activation in the longitudinal and transverse direction central common pathway and in the outer pathway. And it turns out that in the central common pathway, where we have this side-to-side, this lateralization of the connection 43, there is a reduction in both longitudinal conduction and transverse conduction, despite more connection 43 on the lateral membranes. And in the outer pathway, where there was no remodeling of the connection 43, there was still reduction in longitudinal conduction and transverse conduction. I broke my hands, so I can't interpret that right now. I wasn't even going to put the slides in, but I thought But everybody would want to know what are the conduction properties in these regions with lateralized connection 43 and non-lateralized connection 43. And we'll come back to that a little bit later, but that's where that stands right there.
Yes. To what extent is there development of fibrosis at the 3 to 5 years?
There's very little fibrosis. Okay. We can't call on that as being a mechanism. So even though there's lateralized connection 43 at the interface with lines of block form, we're still not sure what the role is in terms of the formation of the lines of block. As it turns out, after, you know, we started those studies in the mid-90s, in the last 10 years or so, there's been a voluminous number of studies showing remodeling of connexin 43 in a number of pathological models and in human hearts as well. And remodeling includes reduction in gap junction plaque number, but not size, ischemic and hypertrophic left ventricle, reduction in gap junction plaque size, and lateralization of connexin 43. That should be an electric reduction. In a large number of models, so lateralization of connexin 43 seems to be a fairly common pathological change in different kinds of heart disease. And none of them, very few studies have tried to figure out what does it mean?
You said that the lung is the protein.
Yeah.
And the function of the actual membrane channels in the protein may be not normal.
I mean, a lot of us, when we started seeing the lateralized connexin 43, interpreted it very simply, like, okay, we're getting a lot of lateral gap junction formation, and that should mean improved transverse conduction. But then the transverse conduction was worse, actually. So it called into question, you know, what is the what are the properties of that lateralized connexin 43? What does it do? And there's still no really know. I mean, it sort of seems funny, you know, after 30 years of work on this model, we still don't know the answer to some of these fundamental questions, so I guess we can keep working for a while. So we've taken two cats. I mean, we're trying to figure out what the stimulus is for lateralization of the connexin 43. That's one thing. And we're trying to figure out what is the molecular mechanism for the lateralization of the connexin 43. These I can go through reasonably quickly. I mean, we did a series of experiments about 3 or 4 years ago where we hypothesized that stretch of the myocardium after coronary occlusion is a stimulus for lateralization. And the hypothesis was that coronary occlusion caused bulging or stretch, which is known to occur in ischemic ventricle. And it was known at that time that release of angiotensin II has effects on connexin 43 metabolism and catabolism from studies on tissue culture. And so some of that was just involved in those studies with Andre Clavier. So we took up on that tissue culture work to see whether in fact this was involved. And maybe you were involved also, but I apologize. My memory is very cool. We did studies in the inside two canine heart without coronary occlusion using a stretch device that we borrowed from Max Lab in England, who did a lot of stretching studies on myocardium. And this device is shown here, has speed on it, which was sutured to the right ventricle. And then you could spread them apart, and they would stretch the myocardium that underneath the stretch device. And then you could stretch it hydraulically. Stretch. And so we stretch the right ventricle rather than the left because the right ventricle is very thin and we could get transmural stretch and that would make the data easier to interpret. And in fact, it turns out that stretching the myocardium for 6 hours did cause lateralization of connexin 43. So seeing that that was a stimulus for lateralization. And then we use the angiotensin 1 receptor blocker, almost dark in some of these studies, and that completely prevented lateralization. And I'm sorry, I don't have a picture of that. I looked more frantically through my files. But this shows some of the data. These are westerns, and this shows non-stretch right ventricle connection 43, and this shows the stretch. So in addition to lateralization, there was a decrease in connection 43, and I think that was different than the tissue culture studies. I think there was an increase in connection 43. But we found a decrease. And then with olmesartan, it prevented the decrease. This is no stretch, and this is stretch plus olmesartan that prevented the decrease in connection. And it also prevented the lateralization. Yeah.
Was that true globally for the whole heart, or was it just
no, just in the region of stretch? We compared the stretch myocardium with the right ventricular myocardium that was not in the stretch region, and with myocardium that was remote.
So is there an upregulation of angiotensin receptors then in that area compared to the rest of the heart?
I don't believe so. I think that when you have bulging of the myocardium, it's a stimulus for angiotensin release for local. You know, the heart has a local renin angiotensin system, and stretch causes angiotensin release in the stretch region. That somehow interacts biochemically with the process of connection 43. And I don't know the mechanism. Has that been worked out? The mechanism by which angiotensin 2 interacts with connection 43
in the cell culture,
right, so which is different. And then just blocking the receptor.
Does the menin do a stretch longitudinally?
You must have confused me. We didn't stretch in both directions, so I don't. And then I'm going to stretch this, and then we'll get going here. Okay, so stretch is a stimulus for remodeling.
Is this the next one talking to you? Do you know if it's in the membrane level?
I'll get to that in a minute. And that comes out of this. I'll take a few minutes to describe this study. So stretch is one stimulus for remodeling. And the other obvious stimulus that we wanted to investigate was low pH. It was low pH that you get after coronary occlusion, a stimulus for gap junction remodeling. And these studies were done by Heather Duffy, came to work with me about 4 years ago as a fellow in my laboratory, and she's leaving next month to go to Boston, and she's taking her laboratory with her, which was my laboratory, to see the progression of events that happened over. Okay, so we started with this working model of connection 43 in the intercalated disc, and I want to describe the players. This is connection 43, membrane-spanning protein, which is anchored in the intercalated disc to another protein, which is called a scaffolding protein, and the protein is called zonula occludens 1, or ZO1. It has other functions besides being an anchoring protein. This particular part of my presentation is called an anchoring protein. So the connection 43 is anchored in the intercalated disc. Can this connection 43 move to the lateral membrane? If it can, how does it do that? Or is there synthesis of new connection 43 that comes to the lateral membrane? So that was one of the problems that we wanted to work out. So even though we didn't quite understand the physiological significance of the lateralization, which we're still working on, in parallel, Heather was working on the molecular mechanism of the lateralization. And the other player in our schema, which will come into play, is another protein called SARC, or CSARC, which is a tyrosine kinase, which is also in the intercalated disc. And look at those. Heather had worked with Paul Sorgen in Nebraska doing NMR studies and neuroresonance studies on the interaction of connexin 43 and Z01, which is the binding site, and the relationship to CSAR. And in those NMR studies, they defined binding domains for SAR in connection in the carboxy-terminal loop of connection 43, as well as the binding domain of the carboxy-terminal for ZL1, which is called a PBZ binding. And it turns out that in these studies in low pH, what happened was that CSAR, which is the tyrosine kinase, was activated by the low pH, and that CSAR somehow causes a conformational change in connexin 43, which then disrupts the binding of connexin 43 to the scaffolding protein Z01. That came out of these NMR studies. It had nothing to do with coronary occlusion. It was not related to any physiological effect. And then what Heather did later is to study astrocytes, which has connexin 43 located on the membrane, as shown here, and has VO1 also stained in green on the membrane of the astrocytes. So the connexin 43 in the astrocytes is bound to the VO1. And then in pH 6.5 in the astrocytes, you can see that the connexin 43, which is in red, is no longer on the membrane and is internalized. The Z01 stays on the membrane. So in the astrocytes, at a low pH, there was uncoupling of the connexin 43 from the Z01. So with that as the background, we undertook a series of experiments in the epicardial border zone to test this model. So here's the model. The model states that in a normal situation, the gap junctions are coupled, are anchored in the interpolated disc to zonula occludens 1 by their carboxy terminal, as shown here, so they can't move. At low pH, it's known that low pH activates this tyrosine kinase, CSAR. And at low pH, the tyrosine kinase binds to the carboxy terminal of the connexin 43, causes a structural reconfiguration, bringing zonula occludens 1 into close proximity to the CSAR, and then CSAR chaperones ZO1 off the connexin 43 terminal, leaving connexin 43 free in the membrane. And then what happens to it is it can be internalized, as in the astrocytes, and destroyed, or we hypothesize that in the border zone that connexin 43 migrates through the lipid membrane to the lateral surface before it's internalized and metabolized. So that was our hypothesis. So, to pursue these studies, first she did immunofluorescence in the epicardial border zone. It turns out that the lateralization of connexin 43 occurs after several hours of coronary occlusion. It occurs very quickly. Even though we get on and look at it at 5 days or 4 days, it really happens very early on. And that is that observation suggested that low pH, in fact, would be a stimulus, because at that time the intracellular pH is low. So if we look at a normal canine heart, we see connexin
43 stained in red at the ends of the cells. This is cadherin, which is another interpolated disc protein. It's just a marker of where the interpolated discs are. 3 hours of occlusion, you can see the lateralization of connexin 43, and after 3 hours of occlusion, the cadherin is still at the ends of the cell. So this is very marked lateralization that occurs within 3 hours of occlusion. So that was one thing. So then we just did some tests of the hypothesis by making measurements in lysates of epicardial border zone. The technique is to remove the epicardial border zone from the infarct, and then in the epicardial border zone, one can measure connexin 43 content, one can measure C-SARC content, and one can measure CO1 content. And here shows data normals 3 hours, 48 hours, 5 days. In this data set, there is an increase in here, which turns out not to be significant, there's an error in this plot. An increase, is, but there's no change in connection 43 content. By 48 hours and 5 days, when there is marked lateralization, there's also a marked decrease in connection. At the same time as there's a decrease, well, there is no decrease here, so I'll get there. The C-SARC measurement showed that at 3 hours there was a marked increase in C-SARC. So that goes along with the hypothesis that C-SARC is activated by the low pH. And then it comes back down to normal. And the ZO1 decreases as well with time. And that also fits with the hypothesis, because as the connexin 43 is assembled from the ZO1 anchoring, the ZO1 appears to be destroyed. Then in doing co-immunoprecipitates, in which you use a primary antibody in a lysate to pull down a protein that you're interested in, and you run the protein antibody combination on a Western, you see what other proteins come down along with that antibody. We did these studies, and you can see here, this shows connexin 43 bound to C-SARC. And normally, it's not bound to C-SARC, but after 30 minutes or an hour, it is bound to C-SARC, which goes along with our model. I'll go back to the model in a little minute. Here we have connexin 43 with ZO1, and you can see that with time, the connexin 43 decreases its association with ZO1, which is in agreement with the model. And here we have C-SARC with ZO1, and you can see with time, the C-SARC with ZO1 increases, so there's a binding of C-SARC to the ZO1, which goes along. Model. We can't, you know, show exactly that the model is correct. We can just show that these data are consistent with the model. So, I'm just going to go to the model. So here's the model again. Connexin 43 is bound to ZO1 in the interpolating disk. So when you do a co-immunoprecipitation studies using antibody connexin 43. The connexin 43 is shown along with ZO1 on your Western gel. They're coupled together. After coronary occlusion and you acidify intracellularly, you get C-SARC activation, and so you get C-SARC binding to the C-SARC binding site on ZO1. So you look at your co-immunoprecipitate data and you see C-SARC ZO1 combination in the gel, which goes along with the model.
And then here, the Z01 binds to the CSR and removes the connection to the oxy terminal from its binding site. If you look at the co-renal precipitate data, you see CSARP-Z01 combination has increased on your western blot gel. So all of those data suggest that the model has some validity. The final part of the story, though, comes from looking at ultrastructural studies of lateral membrane, because remember I said that the connection 43 on the lateral membrane doesn't necessarily have to form functional gap junctions. It's appropriate to measure. And we looked at miles of lateral membrane, well, not really miles, but in normal myocardium, we looked at 6,050 microns worth of lateral membrane and counted lateral gap junctions. And this is the extracellular space in the normal myocardium. And we found no lateral gap junctions, no gap junctions on lateral membranes. In epicardial border zone myocytes, we looked at lateral membrane, and we found 10 gap junctions in 6,000 microns. Now, if you think back to the immunofluorescence studies, where the lateral membranes were layered with connection 43, and you look at these ultrastructure data, and you only see 10 gap junctions, it suggests to me that most of the connection 43 on the lateral membranes is not forming gap junctions. It's just protein. And so what's the significance? Is there any, or have we been wasting our time for 10 years? Well, I don't want to say I've been wasting my time, so I have to apply some significance. And so, my final slide. Our hypothesis is that what happens is when you do a coronary occlusion, you unhook the connection 43 from the scaffolding proteins in the intercalated disc, and the connection 43 moves out of the intercalated disc to the lateral membrane, and from the lateral membrane it's destroyed. And the changes that you're really interested in that are causing conduction changes are in the intercalated disc, because the connection 43 is leaving. And if you look in the intercalated disc, and we've only done a few studies, the interplicate region of the intercalated disc, which is shown here, it's pulled apart, and there's a decrease in the gap junctions in the interplicate region of the intercalated disc in the epicardial pores. So we would hypothesize that they have an impact on conduction. They might be involved in the production block, but I can't prove it. You've been very patient sitting through all of this, and I haven't come to any conclusions, but I'm going to stop here so we have more work.
Thank you, Andy. Questions? I have a question. So, what about the deep region?
The three-day region, we're just starting now to do quantitative morphometric studies on both regions of the IV. And the impression offhand is that there are fewer and smaller gap junctions in the three-day region, but that requires a much higher degree of quantification in order to come up with some real numbers. It's very obvious interplicate region, because in the normal ventricle, you have these long gap junctions in the interplicate region of normal ventricle, and in the border zone, you have marked separation of the myocytes in the interplicate.
So I have to lose it any more from the interplicate region or the extended main.
Yeah.
It's huge. measurements of electrical velocity,
right? Right. Right. So.
And that's the square root of the
Well, conduction can still take place through the ends of the cell.
Right.
Around those areas. Around those areas, right. The significance of the 10 was that we expected to find thousands of gap junctions along the lateral.
So I have a number of questions about the first one. When you said that the metallurized, so where you, the place that you find the metallurized in the lization of the connection point 3 are not changing the conduction, right? Those the conduction are still normal. That's where the border, the border around that metallurized comes from.
Right, it's the interface.
Yeah.
You so don't know the properties of the interface.
Right, so how do your theory work in this case that because of the regularization that you change the conduction law?
I haven't done that before. I don't know. I don't have a theory for that. What I know is from observation, number one, the lines of block form at the border of the remodeled connection 43 and normal. Number two, we find now marked changes in this structure in the borders, in the central common pathway. And beyond that, I can't go any further. Well, I could go further, but I want to at the moment.
So another thing is that I don't know if you have to look at the build on story with the stretch that you
know. No, we haven't done that. It's a good idea, but we did the DO1 experiments long after the fellow who did the stretch study was disappeared and it was just lost in the kitchen zone, so we didn't do the DO1 stretch.
Actually, just because there's conduction from the thin region to the thick region, and there's a big thing, it doesn't actually play a role in
it. Okay, can I just quickly. I still don't know how to give up the 50-minute talk. We published this study now, it kind of goes so fast, it was last year. Ed Chacho did some work, he's been my colleague for 25 years, and he was a very good mathematical biologist in signal processing. And essentially what he did was he measured thickness, so this shows some of his data, measuring thickness of the border zone, different regions. And he correlated the thickness with the lines of block. And he showed that the lines of block were located at the transition of very thin regions, as indicated by the dark blue, and much thicker regions, as indicated by the light blue. And that's just a repeat of what I showed you before. And then he did a lot of modeling, and I don't believe begin to understand the way he modeled wavefront curvature, so I'm not going to try to explain it. But he published in this paper, which will also be presented at Harvard this year. It's been published on Web Ready, but it was invited for publication. This model. So this is a three-dimensional depiction of the infarct border zone. And this is the surface, and this is the. And this is the infarct, so the thickness of the infarct is from here to here. And the thickness of the isthmus is from here to here. And at the junction, and this is the junction of the isthmus with the thicker borders. And through theory about wavefront curvature and source sink relationships and all that. In his model, he showed, at least in the model, that they would be blocked along this entire region because of the tendency of an impulse to try to conduct from a thin region into a thick region. And then he modeled the curvature going from this thin region out into the thick region at the end of the isthmus, how that could be responsible for slope conduction. So that's another factor that now is brought into the whole thinking about what's causing block and what's causing connection. So you're asking that.
And also, if it's a thin and thick border, you probably have different stretch with the thin border, and then that's why you probably have a letterization of the
border. Yeah, it's impossible. I mean, the more you do, the more complicated it becomes.
Any other questions? I just want to, you know, the source seeing listening to the loading different person law.
Right. It's a very important.
On that background, you have to remember that the sodium channel expression is reduced in the border zone. So in the boundaries, it's not uniform. So you have one uniform expression of sodium channels. You have one uniform expression of the connector for the three different locations around the cell. And then you have the distance changes. So it's complicated.
I mean, it's complicated, and it becomes very complicated for you because you're going to be the one that's going to try to eventually model, you know, I'm going to go to a laboratory to model reentry circuits. So the initial approach that Pablo Boyden did already, you know, and that your lab is pursuing, is to model heterogeneities and connectivity and ion channel function. But the geometry and the structure becomes a very important part of the model, and that has to be worked in.
And the fact that ion and sodium channels and other ion channels are different, you know, there's often different things of premature bits, which you usually have.
Yeah.
So you're used to the things with sodium electrical stimulation. Right. And so of all of these, you have the prematurity of the loop that becomes the first piece of the range.
So it's
built out yet.
I have no doubt that you will. And I guess, you know, you start off with something many years ago that looks like it's simple and you can work it out, and this is all on isotropy, and then it just becomes more and more difficult. And as my brain cells are degenerating, the problem gets more difficult, so it's not fair.
All right, thanks.